I'm Elliott Antman. We're here in Barcelona at the ESC Congress, and we're discussing the first hotline session at this international scientific meeting. I'm president of the American Heart Association. I'm pleased to be joined by Dr. Mariell Jessup, immediate past president of the American Heart Association, and Dr. Mark Creager, president-elect of the American Heart Association. So Mariell, hotline one was cardiovascular disease, novel therapies. And obviously, the most important trial that everybody was focusing on was Paradigm HF. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, well, at long last, it looks like we have a blockbuster for heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. And this was a trial that actually substituted this new drug called LCZ-696, doesn't even have a name yet, for enalapril in patients with primarily mild to moderate heart failure symptoms. In this very large trial, which was powered to detect a significant impact on mortality, LCZ-696, in comparison to a good medical regimen with 10 milligrams BID of enalapril, the LCZ arm had a longer survival overall. All-cause mortality was reduced, cardiovascular mortality was reduced, heart failure hospitalizations were reduced, and the primary endpoint, of course, which was cardiovascular death and heart failure hospitalizations reduced. It even made patients feel better as measured by a quality of life score.
Mark, there have been several drugs that have been studied and shown to be effective in heart failure. How does this result compare to the ones we've heard about in the past? Inhibitors of renin-angiotensin system, for example, or beta blockers?
Well, as Mariell just said, this is a very novel and impactful study that's really going to change, if you will, the paradigm of treating congestive heart failure. And it reminds me of several decades ago when angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors first were studied and shown to have remarkable clinical efficacy in patients with congestive heart failure, and then thereafter with beta blockers. I would say the findings from this study are equal in magnitude in terms of its impact on treating patients with congestive heart failure and importantly reducing cardiovascular mortality.
Terrific news about this new drug, and I have to say that one of the questions that we're all getting is, my goodness, when this drug hopefully is approved, would we consider switching patients who are doing well on an ACE inhibitor or ARB to this new agent? And I imagine that question has arisen because of the novel oral anticoagulant experience, where there's some hesitation to switch a patient from a vitamin K antagonist. So, Mariell, you've got a patient who's doing well on a standard therapy with, let's say, an ACE inhibitor. What would you do at that point if you had the drug available?
I think the point has been made over and over. This is a drug that is impactful because it's reducing mortality. We haven't heard a lot about how impactful it was on symptoms, although it was statistically significant. I think it's irrelevant whether the patient's doing well or not. I think you would add this drug to prolong their lives and change, hopefully, the natural history of this disease.
And Mark, how would you approach that? Somebody's in your office practice?
Exactly the same. We are substituting one component of our heart failure therapy. We would be considering doing that, assuming drug approval, and that is the renin-angiotensin system inhibitor. We're still going to treat patients with beta blockers. We're still going to use aldosterone antagonists and diuretics if appropriate. So this is really substituting the renin-angiotensin system inhibitor with its novel dual content. And as Mariell said, one of the important findings of this study is it reduced cardiovascular mortality. So even though these patients were reasonably stable, they had a high risk of death, and that was significantly effective.
One final comment on this. No doubt, a new drug for which the company has spent quite a bit of research and development dollars will be more expensive than the standard drugs we have available. And everybody will say, is it cost effective to switch to this? And let's not focus just on the cost of the pill, because it's really the cost of the system, the cost to the healthcare system. Their hospitalizations are reduced, and surely if patients are feeling better and living longer, a very powerful cost-effective argument can be made in favor of this new drug.
One of the other exciting things is that we do know that they've already started to enroll using this drug in a trial with HEP-PEP, heart failure with preserved ejection fraction.
Mm-hmm.
What if that was positive too?
Oh, my.
Then we have, all we have to do is make the diagnosis of heart failure, and we have a drug that will be shown to be effective.
Across the spectrum.
Which would be really a whole new world.
That would be paradigm changing.
Yes.
So Mark, we heard another trial, CONFIRM-HF, and that investigated the potential benefits of giving intravenous iron. What was the rationale for doing this, and what did the investigators actually do?
Well, this was an interesting study, the CONFIRM trial. And as you mentioned, Elliott, this was a study that was looking at the efficacy of supplemental iron therapy to a placebo control in patients with congestive heart failure and left ventricular systolic dysfunction. Now, the rationale has been that prior studies, preliminary studies, and one clinical trial, FAIR Heart Failure, has demonstrated that iron therapy may improve symptoms in people with congestive heart failure. The reason for that is not entirely clear, but it may have something to do with its effect on hemoglobin. So in this particular trial, there were 300 patients with congestive heart failure who were randomized to carboxymaltose or placebo and followed for 6 months. To get into the trial, they had to have a hemoglobin that was less than 12.5 grams per liter. They had to have a low ferritin level, and they also had to have low transferrin saturation. So not everybody with heart failure was included in the trial. And the primary endpoint at 6 months was the 6-minute walk. And there was also some quality of life instruments that were studied, as well as hospitalization for congestive heart failure as secondary endpoints. And the patients who were randomized to ferric carboxymaltose did have an improvement in the primary endpoint of the 6-minute walk. In fact, their 6-minute walk time improved, whereas the placebo group, it got somewhat worse over the 6 months. In addition, the quality of life measures also indicated improvement with this compound, with iron supplementation, and hospitalizations for congestive heart failure decreased. So very intriguing findings, supportive of a prior study, the FAIR Heart Failure study, and something that does require our attention as we consider additional therapy for congestive heart failure.
Fascinating. Mark, the first thing that everybody would think about when we're giving intravenous iron is, are we correcting some anemia, and is that how the patients are enjoying the benefits that you described? Can you tell us a little bit about what evidence we have that is in favor or against that hypothesis?
So in the trial, they did measure hemoglobin. As I mentioned, to get into the trial, you had to have a hemoglobin of less than 12.5 grams per liter, and it did increase, as well as ferritin levels increase, as well as transferrin saturation, all increased. Now, taking that information and translating it to a mechanistic explanation for the trial is very difficult to do, because I'm not convinced personally that correcting an anemia, which might have been mild, would have really had the impact on improving exercise capacity. In fact, in the past, when we've given erythropoietin and its analogs to improve anemia, that didn't translate into a benefit. So I don't know what the specific mechanism would have been. I think that requires additional study.
Mariell, anything you want to add on that? It's an interesting approach for heart failure.
Well, I think it's an interesting approach, and also it's pretty simple. I mean, about 70% of the patients had only two intravenous iron injections. So one could easily imagine doing that in the outpatient arena.
Let's turn our attention to a few other trials that were presented and discussed at this hotline session. The first is MORE-CRT, and as the name implies, the investigators were attempting to come up with a way that they could actually increase the number of patients with heart failure who could achieve the benefits of cardiac resynchronization therapy, or CRT. One of the most difficult aspects of that is really deploying the left ventricular lead. So what the investigators did here was use a new catheter that had four electrodes, so they had a quadrupolar lead, which offered a much larger combination of possible bipolar configurations. And the interesting findings of this trial, which compare the quadrupolar lead to the bipolar lead, is that there was a significant increase in the technical success at the time of the implant, and there were fewer complications in the quadrupolar group. So, Mariell, this seems to actually broaden our potential ability to give patients the benefits of CRT therapy. All these individuals had a wide QRS, 75% had a left bundle branch block. What's your take on more CRT?
Well, I think as was discussed at the hotline session, we probably are going to have to reserve our judgment till we make sure that the benefit, the clinical benefit of this new approach, which seems to be taking whatever is the best bipolar arrangement, and is that going to still have the same clinical benefit as the traditional bipolar catheters? So I do think we have to hold our enthusiasm a little bit until we make sure we know what the clinical results are.
Very good points. Intriguing observations with a novel catheter. And we'll close our discussion here with two trials that were evaluating colchicine, obviously a drug that's been used for many, many years for gout. We know it has anti-inflammatory effects. And the investigators of these two studies were evaluating colchicine for its benefits in dealing with the complications after cardiac surgery. This kind of investigation has been going on for several years. We heard about the POPE2 trial and the COPS2 trial. And I'm just going to summarize the main findings of these two trials taken in aggregate. Use of colchicine administered late after a pericardial effusion was already noted following cardiac surgery was not effective in preventing progression of that effusion to the point of tamponade, for example. Colchicine was not effective in preventing the development of the pericardial effusion in the first place. Depending upon how the data were analyzed, there was a suggestion that there may be a reduction in postoperative atrial fibrillation. The positive finding here was a reduction in the post-pericardiotomy syndrome. So you've been listening to discussions about colchicine for many years here. What's your take on what the POPE2 and COPS2 trials have told us at this point?
Yes, I must say that it's been a real mixed bag of results. And I think when you talk to the investigators themselves, they start to talk about the GI side effects of colchicine, which we're all very used to. Picture taking colchicine in that perioperative period where you're also taking H2 blockers, antibiotics,
pain medications.
So it's easy to understand that they have a lot of adverse reactions. So without a really compelling indication to administer colchicine, I don't think I'm going to change my clinical practice.
How about you, Mark? What's your take?
Well, first, to highlight the two trials today, the POPE2 trial was administered colchicine at least a week after surgery, and they were administering primarily to patients who had a pericardial effusion to make sure they didn't get worse and develop tamponade. So this is somewhat late in the game, and it was not effective in that study. In the COPS2 trial, they were looking at something a little bit different and used a different strategy. Here, the colchicine was administered before surgery, and they were specifically looking for the development of post-pericardiotomy syndrome. And it was effective in doing so, but it didn't prevent pericardial effusions or pleural effusions. And as you already mentioned, in the intention to treat analysis, it didn't reduce the risk of atrial fibrillation. And as Mariell mentioned, there's association with increased gastrointestinal side effects. So I find the information important. And as we've seen in other trials of colchicine for preventing recurrent pericarditis, its initial effect will be beneficial in the post-pericardiotomy syndrome. But the timing of the dose, which does not necessarily have to be before surgery as we move forward, and who should specifically get it, that remains to be determined.
So I'm going to predict that we're going to be seeing more trials of colchicine, and we'll be reporting on them as they are unfolded over the ensuing years. It was an exciting first day. Hotline 1 had lots of new information for us. And that's our summary today from sunny Barcelona at the ESC meeting for AHA Science News. Thank you for listening.